I saw a dream, because at the time I was working at the bank and I was not happy. And my father always, from the time we were kids, if you're not happy when you get up in the morning to go to work, you need to find a job or a career that's going to make you happy. Otherwise, you're just not going to be happy. You're not going to be glad to roll over and get out of the bed. You need to find your purpose for getting out of that bed. And for me, it's always been reading. It's always been writing. But for a long time, I didn't believe I can make a career out of that. I'm from a small town in New Jersey, and I didn't believe like a woman of color from a small town in New Jersey could do that. I didn't see that. So I had like a lot of doubts, and that's, I think that's why it took me so long. But I always had that passion. I did not want to do that for the rest of my life. And I was still wanted to be published. I still wanted to see my book on the bookshelves. But still, it was seeing my book out there getting in the hands of readers. That was so amazing to me. That's what I wanted. And so that's what kept me hungry. That's what kept me pursuing it. Coming into contact with other people who were doing it, that's what kept me encouraged. That's why I never gave up.
Welcome to the Stark Reflections on Writing and Publishing podcast. There has never been a better time for writers. More information, options, and opportunities are available to you, but navigating these requires insight. Join Mark Leslie Lefebvre as he draws upon more than a quarter century of experience as a writer, a bookseller, and a trusted book industry consultant to explore and reflect on the writing and publishing landscape to help you make informed choices on your writer journey.
Hello, Reflectives, and welcome to episode 257 of the Stark Reflections podcast. This is your host, Mark Leslie Lefebvre. In today's episode, I have a wonderful conversation with Naima Simone. Published since 2009, USA Today bestselling author Naima Simone loves writing sizzling romances with heart, a touch of humor, and snark. Her books have been featured in the Washington Post and Entertainment Weekly, and has been described as balancing crackling electric love scenes with exquisitely rendered characters caught in emotional turmoil. She's wife to Superman, none other than Superman, or at least his non-Kryptonite, less bulletproof equivalent, and mother to the most awesome kids ever. They all live in perfect, sometimes domestically challenged bliss in the southern United States. And my interview with Naima comes up later in this episode. I had the honor of getting to meet her. She was one of the guests of honor at Pikes Peak Writers Conference earlier this year. After I heard her speak, I had to have her come on the podcast so that you, dear listener, could benefit from listening to this awesome woman. And that's coming up later in the podcast. First, let's hear some comments, word from this episode's sponsor, personal update, you know the drill. This episode is sponsored by Findaway Voices. Now, Findaway Voices offers you authors the ability to get your audiobooks out into the global marketplace with access to more than 43 retail and library channels, and they continue to add new ones. They also allow you to set your price. You can even set promotional prices. So, for example, I've got A Canadian Werewolf in New York on Chirp, Barnes & Noble Nook, Apple, and Google Play, at a special price of $2.99 done through Findaway Voices as part of a July 1st to September 30th promo. Great thing about audiobooks is, unlike the locked-in restrictions that you have with ebooks where you have to have the same price everywhere, there are no such terms with audio. It's wholesale pricing, which means you can have different prices on different platforms. I've had some amazing Chirp deals in this year alone, two awesome Chirp deals, and you can only get Chirp deals through Findaway Voices. And I'll be honest with you, it was the Chirp deals that actually allowed me to pay for one full, get my money back, to earn back what I paid for the narration for one of my books. And I'm also, about 60 to 70% away from paying for the second of my audiobooks, because audiobooks are a long-term investment for indie authors. But if you're looking at investing in your indie author career, whether you're looking to find a professional narrator through Findaway Voices Marketplace, or if you have the audio that you've purchased yourself or recorded yourself professionally you can use Findaway Voices for distribution. So, want to invest in yourself and in your audiobook future as an author? Check out Findaway Voices, and you can check them out over at starkreflections.ca/findaway. And now for some comments. So over on Patreon, where my awesome patrons support me at patreon.com/starkreflections, Malcolm Kuhn shared on the community Patreon community page. He said, "Hey Mark, I saw this article in my hometown newspaper and thought of you. Ghost story set for old jail, and it's from the Fredericksburg Standard. And as he says, the building was vacant and creepy when he was growing up there several decades ago. Now they're planning ghost tours. Apparently there's already a ghost tour company in town. The tour company petitioned the county court and the historical society to include the old jail and on their tour route and get access to the inside." And then he says the court and the historical society agreed after the tour company agreed to accept all liability, get insurance, and pay the historical society $1,000 per month for use of the building. And what I loved about Malcolm at the end, he said, "Even ghosts have a price." So thank you, Malcolm, for that. I love getting access to stuff like that because I do use those sorts of articles and insights for some of the true ghost story books that I write. So I appreciate that, Malcolm. I appreciate you, Malcolm, and all the other folks who support me over at patreon.com. Now, over on the Twitter sphere, Edwin Downward was reflecting on last week's episode, episode 256, which was a solo episode where I was just talking about measuring your worth, etc. And Edwin said, "How do you reflect on a stark reflection with Mark Leslie that is, in effect, one big reflection, this time on how to include all those hard-to-quantify inputs into the price of producing one of our novels? This may require further reflection." I see what you did there, Edwin. Nicely done. Nicely played, sir. And also on the Twitter sphere, Connor Whiteley tweeted this in response to an ad I had shared on Twitter. For Lover's Moon, a book that Julie Strauss and I recently released, the paranormal romantic comedy. And Connor says, "Have to admit, this is probably my favorite book ad ever. Check it out." Now, I replied with, and this is what I love about Twitter, is I replied with, "Thanks, Connor. The idea slash concept was totally Julie's brilliant idea. She used it for an ad on her best book ever podcast." And then I sort of readapted that ad for the share that I did. And then Paula Johansson said, "If I buy Julie a chai latte, will she help me plan an ad for my book?" And of course, I did reply with something to the effect that she can be bribed with coffee or wine. And so, because I teased that out, I am going to just shortly play, instead of a bumper, the regular bumper, I'm going to just play the ad. Julie, what do you know about werewolves?
Absolutely nothing, Mark. I'm scared of everything. What do you know about romance novels?
Well, my mom read a ton of romance when I was a kid, and Fabio was always on the cover, so Fabio must be in every romance novel, right?
That's exactly right, yes. Mark, do you know what we should do?
I do, yeah.
Let's say it at the same time, okay?
Okay. 1, 2, 3... Never speak again.
Write a book together.
Yes, that, what you said. We should write a book together.
I was thinking we could each write about our favorite things.
Yeah, bloody fangs.
And making out.
Occult shops.
Having sex in a bubble bath.
Ancient feuds.
A marriage proposal in Central Park.
A book made of human skin.
And friendly honeybees.
We've really got something here.
You know, I don't see how it could fail.
Lover's Moon by Mark Leslie and Julie Strauss is now available everywhere you buy books.
Wait, Mark, what was that thing you said earlier?
Don't worry about it. And there you go. That was the fun ad from Julie and I for Lover's Moon. And that's it for the introductory matter. I'm not going to get into a personal update other than to say I am hard at work on my 35th anniversary edition celebration of Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, the Canadian Mounted. I had a good friend of mine that recommended, why don't I reach out to see if I can interview Steve Martin for the book? And I thought, why? Why didn't I think of that? What's wrong with me? So I'm going to be doing that. also working really hard on a new promotion that I'm working on for the Levack Onapean Public Library, where I'm going to be doing the Creatures in the Library anthology, which is basically for young people, 21 years of age and younger from my hometown, an opportunity for them to be published and to win some prizes, etc. And I'm doing it in collaboration with the Greater Sudbury Public Library, and I'm so excited. I just got off the phone with one of the head librarians in Sudbury, and he's pretty pumped about helping with that, and I'm really thrilled and really excited. So lots of stuff going on, lots of traveling, lots of back and forth. There will continue, as there always is, dear friends. There will always be an episode coming out every Friday, and so I have to work really, really hard at that as I travel to get these things produced in advance. So I'm probably going to cut short on those personal updates. But that is it for the introductory matter. Why don't we get right in to the interview with Naima Simone. Now, just before we get into the interview, I just have to let you know that on the day that Naima and I recorded this, her internet was buggy and giving her some issues and some troubles. So there's occasionally some glitches that you'll hear in the audio feed. But for the most part, because of the context, even if you miss a word or here or there, you kind of know what exactly she's saying. And I think it is a phenomenal interview, but I just wanted to let you know in advance you may hear some of those little glitchy things, but it does not take away from the brilliance and the fun that we have. Naima, welcome to the Stark Reflections podcast.
Thank you. I'm so excited to be here because I enjoyed Pikes Peak, so I'm so delighted to be here.
Well, that's what I was saying is I met you at Pikes Peak Writers Conference a few months ago, and you did the opening keynote, and it blew me away. It was what perfect way to kick everything off, get everyone in the right mood. And I thought, oh my God, my listeners have to hear her because this is awesome. So thank you for agreeing to come on the podcast.
Oh, thank you for inviting me.
So I want to go back to the first sort of thing is you've got this amazing tagline. And a tagline is where heart, humor, and heat collide. And I think you've every once in a while in interviews, you've snuck in and a lot of snark. Is that true?
Yeah, I admit it. I'm a snarky person. So my books take a lot of it, a lot of sarcasm. So yeah, you will find that.
Okay.
So I should have substituted like humor for snark, but you know, alliteration and all that.
Yeah, you got to have heart humor and right. I like that though. So I'm curious then, was it always romance for you? Was that the thing you always wanted to write?
It's just always, just when I was younger, I read, Sweet Valley High, and I read like my absolute favorite book in the world. I was just talking with someone about this, and The Witch in the Wardrobe, and of course, Charlie and the Chocolate. So of course I read this growing up, but my mother is the one responsible for introducing me to romance because she read it. And when she worked the third shift when I was younger, so work my sneaker would go into her room and sneak her books and read them, which I'm sure like she would be so she would have been like so horrified right now because we should not have been reading that at 11 and 12.
But that's the
captured.
Yeah, and that's the thing that so avid readers, most of my friends who are diehard readers today admit to being at the age of around 11 and females, and they always found their mom's books they shouldn't have read. Sometimes It was Flowers in the Attic. It was other things like that.
I read that too. And now that I'm thinking about that, I'm like, oh God, I shouldn't have been reading that. Not at all.
And yet you were reading. So it was kind of like, yes, you were reaching content that was probably not for an 11-year-old mind.
I didn't understand part of it.
You were reading more at an advanced level though, weren't you?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, absolutely. And I have to give my parents credit for that too, because I mean, I read very early because they started my sister and I out reading fairy tales. They set the footprints for this. I kind of feel like I had no choice with romance because we were reading my first book. You know, when you're younger, you memorize them first, and that's how you start recognizing the words, and then that's how you start reading. And mine were fairy tales with the happily ever after, not grim, but
right. the ones that got a little bit friendlier for kids, right?
Right. so that's what, you know, we were reading, and we learned to read at like 3 and 4. And so by the time I hit 11, I was reading Joanna Lindsay and Julie Garwood and Beatrice Small and V.C. Andrews. So that set the framework for what I wrote later.
Okay. So at 11, you're sneaking in into your mom's room and you're finding the books and learning about the world. At what point did you sneak in and grab a fountain pen and a piece of paper? Like, at what point did you actually start writing some of the stories that came to your mind?
I wrote my first book was about a cucumber named Fred who went to the bookstore. That was like in the third grade.
And Fred the cucumber went to the bookstore.
He went to the bookstore.
What was he there for?
He was just returning a book to the bookstore, which makes no sense because he should have been returning it to the library instead of the bookstore. Yeah. And the cucumber really looked like an amoeba now that I think about it, because he had hair. So yeah, but you know, less said about Fred, the better. But my second book was a romance, and that was in seventh grade.
Fred met a pickle?
He did. Okay, that's good. And I'm going to be stealing that.
Sorry, the second book was a romance. I'm sorry.
It was like I'm thrown off all off track now. It was eight, and I wrote my first romance, and it starred Vent from New Edition, and he my eye across a crowded gymnasium where him and the rest of the guys were performing at a homecoming dance. Okay. And so of course we were happily in love, but there were a lot of trials. Like I committed the cardinal sin in romance, which is I almost killed him off like at the end, but I thought it was very dramatic. You know, he ended up in ICU, and then I went back to my fairy tale roots. I woke him up out of a coma with a kiss. So that was my first romance.
Well, you were like the prince that shows up and wakes up Sleeping Beauty, right?
I was way ahead of my time in movement because I woke him up instead of waiting on the prince.
Well, but that's a sign of a strong female lead, right?
Exactly. Exactly.
So that was would we call that fantasy fiction?
Yeah.
So did you ever get to meet him in real life?
No, that's the fantasy part.
Okay, that was the fantasy part. Maybe he shows up at a book signing one day.
Come through, Ralph. Come through. My door is still open. You know, what's funny is the first book that I ever sold was actually a reincarnation of one of the many romances that I wrote, because my sister and I would trade stories. We wrote romance stories, I guess you could call them like short stories now, where Duke and Scarlet and Lady J and Thundercats, like we were like fan fiction like ahead of our time. But the next book that I wrote was with Donnie Wahlberg from Block. Well, the book that I had written in college that starred Donnie Wahlberg, I didn't put myself in it this time, but the heroine might have looked a lot like me, but that's neither here nor there. But it was Donnie. That became the reincarnation of it many, many times over became the first book I sold.
Really? Really? Yes. Yeah. So it was kind of like you were cutting your chops and then you just kept changing it and modifying it. Donnie became some other character.
Right. his name was not Donnie in it, but he did look a heck of a
did
lot.
Did it become
like
Mark Wahlberg maybe? No.
Mark might have been in the another book that I wrote.
Oh, that's fantastic. So tell me about that first book. So what was that process? You know, writing stories for fun, trading them with your sister, having those fun, you know, moments of the boy bands and the romance moments. And then at what point did that become a thing that you actually thought, hey, there's something here that I can actually work with?
I mean, it took a lot. Like that first book, I started it like seriously pursuing it, thinking maybe I can write a book and have it published. When I was on maternity leave, and it took me 10 years to actually see it published because it went through so many reincarnations. Right. And I took classes in between then, and I joined RWA in between then, and I learned so much about craft in between then, and the book became a lot better between then. You know, I just learned about writing. You know, of course I finished it because that's rule number one, finish the book. But I had to still learn about writing, like what it was, like, you know, the mechanics of it. And then I submitted it, and then it, you know, it ended up being published. Like it ended up being after I submitted it, ended up being contracted and published. But for me, that was a journey. Like that took from the time I started to the time that it was actually contracted and published. That was like for me.
Wow. Was that through an agent? Did you have multiple agents, or was this just a cold submissions directly to?
It was a cold submission.
Yeah.
It was a cold submission. I actually, for most of my career, I haven't had an agent because most of the publishers that I wrote for were smaller houses, and they didn't require agents. Right. When I did acquire an agent, it, you know, then I started writing for bigger houses like Harlequin and you know, now Montlake, and so that now I am. But for a good part of my career, I didn't have one.
What was it that made you persist, that made you continue in the face of, like, this wasn't a quick turnaround, this was a lot of work?
I think it's because I saw a dream that I knew what I was doing, because at the time I was working at the bank and I was not happy. What I wanted to do with my life, it wasn't my passion. And my father always, from the time we were kids to we were all through our adulthood, if you're not happy when you get up in the morning to go to work, you need to find a job or a career that's going to make you happy. You need passion.
Right.
Otherwise, you're just not going to be happy. You're not going to be glad to roll over and get out of the bed. You need to find your purpose for getting out of that bed. And for me, it's always been reading. It's always been writing. But for a long time, I didn't believe I can make a career out of that. I'm from a small town in New Jersey, and I didn't believe, like, a woman of color from a small town in New Jersey could do that. I didn't see that. So I didn't have that example until later, women of color who could romance. So I didn't see that. I was at first pursuing it. So I had like a lot of doubts, and I think that's why it took me so long. But I always had that passion. I knew I did not want to work at something that made me sad, that didn't inspire me. I did not want to do that for the rest of my life. And I also didn't want to see my kids see me doing that.
Right.
I wanted them to see me doing something that would inspire them to be beyond me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And for me, that was, even if I had to work the night and still be published, I was still wanted to be published. I still wanted to see my book on the bookshelves. Because at that, e-publishing was very new.
Yeah.
And so my first book was e-publishing, and that the first steps for me. But still, it was seeing my book out there getting in the hands of readers. That was so amazing to me. That's what I wanted.
Yeah.
And so that's what kept me hungry. That's what kept me pursuing it. Coming into contact with other people who were doing it, that's what kept me encouraged. So that's why I never gave up.
Cool. I love that. Now, during your keynote, you shared that anticipation of that first royalty check that was going to be that life-changing moment for you.
Yeah.
Can you share a little bit of that so my listeners can
can benefit from that wisdom.
Yeah. So this was, I'd actually been published for about 6 years, but I was published with the, I don't know the name. And so, but I had recently contracted with the publisher at that time, and who still is like a wonderful publisher. And at that time, I saw as the next step in my career, and it ended up being, but I was excited because I'm like, here is where the next level of my career is going to take off. And I had even become at that point, become a full-time writer, because I knew this was it. This was where I'm going to elevate. And so that book, the first book with this publisher came out. I was so excited. I knew this was going to. And before I had decided to be a full-time writer, my husband and I had prayed on it. And we were like, okay, we're going to sleep of faith together. This is going to be it. And if God said it's right, there's no way we can fail. So you didn't fail, God. So I'm in the, that morning, I got the email with my first royalty check. Now this is, if you know, if for like your listeners, like you don't get like with the publishing house, you still are in the hole. So by the time I got my first royalty check, my book had been out for like 5 months.
Right.
So I'm getting a royalty check for like 5 months of royalties. And so I opened up that email. I looked at the statement, excited. I looked at it. I zoomed it in. I looked at it again. This can't be right. Surely there's some zeros over to the side, like, because this can't be right. This can't be right. And then I looked at it again, but no, that check said $213.14. Now, mind you, that's over 5 months. So, like, my math is not strong. I'm not a math wizard. Like, but that's not even $50 a month. I was so crushed. Now, I'm in the church parking lot at this time and about to go in. And it's funny that I'm in the church park. I see this and I'm about to go in and I am crushed, devastated, because I'm looking at $213.14. And I'm like, this can't be right, because God, I know that we received the word and no, we can't run a family on $200.14. This, the devil is a lie. And then, you know, people are coming, going into the church and they're like, how you doing? I'm like, blessed and highly favored. And I'm trying to play it off. I'm trying to keep up a good face. And inside, I'm just like dying. I'm like crying inside. And so my father pulls up. My father's a pastor. My father pulls up and he gets out. And he's like, hey, what's going on? I looked at him and I just bawled. I just broke down and he just hugged me. And all I could say was, it's $213.14. And I'm not going to lie. I almost gave up. I almost gave up that right. In the parking lot, yeah. Because I felt like this check was going to be the validation of all the hard work I had put in so far, of the huge step I had taken, not just with the publisher, but in here with my family, you know, depending on me, with, you know, taking this step with me. And I was ready to quit. And then my father had to really talk to me and remind me of why I was in this.
Right.
It's for the money. You wants to pay doing what they love, but it's also because this is your passion. It's the road is not always easy. It's not straightforward. There are going to be valleys. There's going to be disappointments. There's going to be, but you can't be wrecked on those disappointments.
Right.
And because I started here doesn't mean that I won't end up here. But if I quit, I will never know here. You know, I'll never know that high point. And so he talked me down. Like he talked me down and I sucked it up. I went into church. And I got it together and I did not quit. I didn't. I persevered. And I'm just going to be very honest. There were more checks like that, $213.
Right.
But eventually they increased. You know, I grew in readership. I got writing. Even though those, to me, that was the best book I've written so far in my career. And right. I still stand by that. But I had to grow as a writer. And that check will always remind me of that moment where I almost gave up and I would not have seen where I am now and where I'm going.
Yeah. And it's a good thing you didn't, because you kept at it and then things kept growing. Look at the bestseller list you've been on and the awards, like all the things that have happened because you didn't give up. Now, you didn't know at the time probably, but this is something that I just want to put out there, is that this is only 5 months. And this also was after the advance. So this means the advance had to be paid out, which means there's nothing, like you only start earning money after you get that back.
Well, so, with this publisher, I didn't get an advance.
Oh, there was like, no advance?
Yeah,
on this.
There was no advance. So this is like straight.
Oh, okay.
Royalty.
I was thinking, because I was going to say most books never earn their advance out and you got it back in 5 months. That was awesome.
No. So that makes it even sadder. Thanks.
Oh,
Mark.
That's even that sadder. Okay. But okay. Let me throw another stat out there that in Canada, most books make less than $1,000 ever. So I'm trying to prop you up here. I'm saying that was actually, that wasn't so bad for the first time. Oh, but that was, you know, to think about where you were and you almost gave up and then you just kept it, you know, your dad helped and he talked through it, reminded you that you were writing for the passion.
Yeah.
And you kept telling your stories. I'm sure your husband, the Superman, as you describe him, was by your side.
Absolutely. He's a rock, because he would there. Because I can't say that wasn't the only time that I wanted to quit.
Right.
You know, and not even quit, but there were times I was like, let me just get a part-time job, you know?
Yeah.
And he was like, no, this, you're going to focus on writing. And that's what you're going to focus on. I have us. Did we have to cut back on things? Yes. But he had me. He would not let me lose focus. And he would not let me forget why that full-time job. He would not let me forget why I was in it. The passion that I had for what my goals were. He wouldn't let me forget it.
Right. I didn't get a chance to chat with your husband, but I got to see him in action. Good looking man, Cool. Nappy dresser. But you know what stood out? When you went up to give your keynote talk, he walked you up to the stage, held your hand as you went up the stairs, and my heart melted. It was just such a romantic thing.
Romantic.
And I was like, what a sweetheart of a guy. And then when you finished, and we all stood up and applauded and everything. And then he came and grabbed you by the hand and led you back down. And I just kept thinking, oh my God, he's there for her.
that's just like that. That's just the epitome of who he is. He's
yeah.
And it's funny because I write romance, but he's the romantic in this relationship.
he's the romantic
he's just
one.
Such an awesome guy. He's totally the romantic one in this relationship. He's just an awesome guy. And I wouldn't be able to do this without such a wonderful partner, a supportive partner.
Right.
So what you saw there is who he is.
Yeah. I got that feeling like this is a guy I'd like to get to know. He's a pretty cool guy. He can teach other men how to be respectful. And
yes. All of that.
He must have made it into a few characters here and there.
I will say this. Because I can't even name, his name is Gary, and I can't even name Gary because I'm like, it's just weird. Like, it's weird. But a lot of his characteristics have made it into my heroes. Like, that vulnerability, like, I write a lot of alphas, but they're men who are, even if they're growly and hard or hard-end on outside, they have that core of honor and vulnerability inside and respect for women, and that's who he is to the core, you know. So his characteristics make it into roles.
That's fantastic. Well, give him a big hug for me, because I really admire the guy. You work with some publishers, obviously Harlequin, Montlake are two of the big publishers that you've worked with, among others. But you've also indie published some of your work?
I have, yes. Yeah.
How do you decide if you're going to send this to a publisher or this one's going to be one that you do yourself?
Just like I the stories that are I have to like burning inside me to write that might be a little risque or a little taboo, or those are the ones that like if a story pops in my head and it's short and it knock out like a 30k or 40k, it's like okay I want to write this, even if it's a 20k, I want to write this, I want to get it out and I'll write it, you know, because publishers have certain things. And if some of the books that I've self-published may not fit what they're looking for. And then sometimes there have been opportunities where I've written with other writers for like anthologies or something. And I try not to, unless it's like a, you know, it's conflicting with my schedule. I don't like passing up on those opportunities.
Right.
And those are self-published because there's just something special about writing with a group of writers or units and like brainstorming with them and collaborating with them. And I don't want to pass that up. So when those opportunities come, I write, and I then I have the freedom of writing what I want to. I don't have to send in a synopsis approved or an idea to get it approved, or you know, I don't have to go through all of that. I can write whatever I want to, whatever comes in my head.
And you're not victim to a publishing cycle at certain dates, certain times.
No.
So I imagine your fans must be excited. Oh, we get another one this year?
and that's always exciting when I can just drop like a book that's not, you know, just like in between dates of, you know, the traditional, and it's something that's not in the series that they've come to know and come to like really, really enjoy. It's something totally brand new, something like different from those, but still me.
Right.
But it's something they weren't expecting. And it's like, I get to just drop it. That's always fun.
Oh, that's cool. I love that. You can play on both sides and have a good time.
Yeah.
So you've got a couple forthcoming releases. And I saw recently you had shared on social media that one of your forthcoming releases, there was a rock star from the 80s who happened to have commented, connected somehow. Can you explain what happened with the...
Okay, see, the series is, like, the idea of the series is that I'm taking, like, I'm an 80s child, you know, I love everything 80s, but especially the music. And so I'm taking like some of my favorite 80s hits and using them as books, like in this series. So the first book was Jesse's Girl, and from iconic song by Rick Springfield, right?
Yeah.
And I was driving, and I was like, because the song came on the radio.
Yeah.
And I was like, but what would have happened if Jesse told her how he felt, or she found out? I mean, if Jesse's, you know, Jesse's friend told her how he felt, or she found out that Jesse's friend was in love with her or wanted her, what would happen?
Yeah.
So I'm like, let's write that story.
Oh my God.
So, so I wrote that story and I named it Jesse's Girl, right? So apparently, I don't know how Rick Springfield came across my book. I don't know. But apparently he came across my book and he commented on, like, he commented on it because he has a podcast and he had just been talking about how song titles can't be copyrighted. Like the songs themselves can be, like, but the titles can't. And so he came across my book some way and he shared the cover and he said something like, you know, as I said, song titles, he copyrighted, but take a look at this one. Looks a little lascivious. And I'm like, yeah, Springfield. It's Rick Springfield.
and that was a 10 cent word he used too.
Lascivious. I'm like, go Rick.
That was so awesome.
I posted about it, said, no, it's not a little lascivious. It's a lot.
Capital L.
A capital L-O-T.
Oh, so I do have to ask, because he does have a podcast. Are you sending him a copy, signed copy, maybe?
Like, people have suggested that, and I'm like, I might.
I reach out and say, I would love to send you a signed copy.
I think that would be a great idea. I just might do it.
Because imagine having a picture of Rick Springfield holding your book, right?
He
didn't have to wish anymore. He has Jesse's girl.
That's right.
Yeah. Your dream come true after, I don't even want to count how long it's been since the 80s, because I think that the 70s were 30 years ago.
So. Yeah, right. And the 80s were 20. So, yeah. And that's our math, and that we're sticking to it.
When is this, when is Jesse's Girl coming out?
It came out on May 24th.
Oh, it's out already. Oh, sorry. I thought it was forthcoming. Oh, so it's out already.
It's already out. Yeah.
Okay, cool. So we know where to find a woman like that, right?
That's right. On Amazon. Go get it.
Cool. Well, we'll have links to that book and where you can get all your other books over at starkreflections.ca. So... just as we get to the close, one of the things I love to ask my guests is, if you could go back to the young Naima and talk to this writer who wanted to be a writer and was dreaming of that, what's some advice that you would go back and give your younger self?
I think I would tell her, stop putting yourself so much. Just stop with the what ifs, the I can'ts, nobody wants to read this, stop that. Just write and try. And if you know, which I did, it's not the end of the world, and keep pushing. Because I had so many doubts, and because I told myself I couldn't, so it took me 10 years to get book published. And even though I was still working in the background and I was still working on the book, a lot of it was me. And so I would stop that. There are readers for every readers who want to read the story you have to tell. So just be brave.
Awesome. That is great inspiration, not only for the younger you, but for other writers.
Yeah, for me now.
Yeah, for you now, for all of us now. Can you please share with my listeners where they can find you and your books online?
Sure. You can find all of them at www.naimasimone.com. I'm on Facebook at Naima Simone Author and Instagram at Naima Simone Author.
Awesome. There'll be links, of course, in the show notes for Stark Reflections. Naima, I want to thank you so much. I had an absolute howl blast of a time chatting with you.
Thanks too, for
coming and hanging out with me tonight.
Thank you so much for having me. I had so much fun.
Well, what a fascinating conversation with Naima. I had a really good time, and I wanted to focus specifically on one of those moments. It was a pivotal moment she spoke about, sitting in the church parking lot, and her father, who her dream of being a writer was inspired by something her father had told her from when she was a young girl, and then he comes back when she's sitting in the church parking lot and he's there for her again. It's that pivotal moment I want to think about, where she saw the check and had all of her hopes and dreams riding on that check, and was just so devastated, trying to put on a brave face, all the things. Saw her father, she couldn't hold it in, let it out, and he was there for her. But that pivotal moment where she could have given up, where she could have stopped, where she could have just given up, and we would not have as many, she did have some books out already, but we would not have as readers, we would not, as writers as well, Naima Simone's books, as many as have been published, and think of the tens of thousands of readers out there who have been inspired by her. Writers like you and I who have been inspired by her and the fact that she did not give up. Think about that pivotal moment. There can be a pivotal moment when you're thinking of as a creative person in the craft of writing. What's that pivotal moment for a character? in your story? What is it, that thing that they almost just pushes them right to the edge and they almost stop, or they almost give up on that goal, on that dream, on that lifelong pursuit? Were there any moments in your life as a writer where there was that pivotal moment and you could have decided to just give it up or to keep going, to keep working at that dream, to keep working at that passion? It reminds me of something. A writer recently, a local writer, had reached out to me and said, "Hey, Mark, how do you decide what events you're going to do as an author? I see you've booked an event. I'm doing an event this coming weekend on July 10th. And how do you decide if it's going to be worthwhile?" Because I had done an event, and I think, you know, maybe 100 people came to the whole place all day, and it was a huge waste of time. And my response was, well, no, this is not going to be very mathematical, and it's not going to be very business-oriented, and it's not going to be very logical, but here's how I decide. Now, sometimes you do have the business-oriented and the savviness and stuff like that, but sometimes when I don't know, because this is a new event and I've never been to it before, when I don't know, I decide based on whether or not I'm going to enjoy it. Is this going to be fun? Am I going to have a good time? Am I going to make the best of this experience? And even if I don't sell a lot, or I don't sell anything or whatever, I win, because I got to do something that I decided I wanted to do because it was fun. I meet new people. I mean, I've gone and done book signings where I've been there for 3 hours and did not sell a single book, but I still think of that event as a success because I spent 3 hours getting to really know some cool booksellers, and they were really wonderful people, and we had some great conversations. So I learned, I grew from that experience. I had a good time. I got to meet new people. That was a success. I didn't make money. It was kind of a waste of that time, but it was also considered a success. And I know that's a weird approach, especially because I like to talk about the business of writing and publishing, but sometimes you've got to follow those passions. Sometimes you've got to follow those dreams. And hopefully, like Naima, when you follow those passions, when you follow those dreams, when you do not give up in those pivotal moments, that can make all the difference for you and your writing. Well, that's it for this episode. That's it for my post-interview reflections from this episode. I hope you found the podcast entertaining. I hope you loved hearing from Naima just as much as I loved chatting with Naima. Links, of course, over at starkreflections.ca. If you like the podcast, one of the ways you can help me out is by sharing it with someone that you think would find value in it. You can also leave a review over on the podcatcher of your choice. So thanks again for listening to the Stark Reflections podcast. Until next week and next episode, this is Mark Leslie Lefebvre wishing you great writing and good Stark Reflections.
Thank you for listening to the Stark Reflections podcast. You can find show notes for each episode at starkreflections.ca.
The music for this podcast, Laser Groove, was composed and produced by Kevin MacLeod. Check out more of Kevin's great music at incomptech.com.